Everybody, welcome to Transformation Tuesday Bible Study. Today we're going to be talking about Kingdom Men of Excellence. The last time we talked about females and their characteristics as godly women, so we're going to focus on men and what that means as husbands, kingdom partners, and just them in general, how they're supposed to behave towards us and even society. So that's going to include the fact that they're supposed to be wise, honest, dignified. Of course, they're providers and they're productive. We are not to go by what the world thinks men should be. Right now, the definition of that is completely terrible, probably the worst I've seen in years, and really is degrading to men, to be honest with you. So that's what we're going to focus on today. I want us to pray really quick, and then we're going to get right into it. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that everybody listening understands your definition of what men should be and how that is superior to whatever definitions are going on in any country, in any state, anywhere, especially the United States of America. This is needed right now so that when females are thinking about what their husband's supposed to be behaving like or what their kingdom partner's supposed to be behaving like, they look to you, God, and look to your word and not people who are of this world. We are not to be of this world. We are to be of your world and your word. God, thank you so much. I pray that this message penetrates them deeply and that they're able to use it in their daily lives. Thank you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, amen. All right, so let's get started. So everyone, let's start with Proverbs chapter 12, verses 1 through 7. That's Proverbs chapter 12, verses 1 through 7. Whoever loves instruction loves knowledge, but he who hates correction is stupid. A good man obtains favor from the Lord, but a man of wicked intentions he will condemn. A man is not established by wickedness, but the root of righteousness cannot be moved. An excellent wife is the crown of her husband, but she who causes shame is like rottenness in his bones. The thoughts of the righteous are right, but the counsels of the wicked are deceitful. The words of the wicked are lie in wait for blood, but the mouth of the upright will deliver them. The wicked are overthrown and are no more, but the house of the righteous will stand. So kingdom men are wise and righteous. You know, they want to live repentant lifestyles. They're not wicked and they don't buy into wickedness. They don't obtain anything they get through wickedness and through lying. They are really, really stuck on being repentant and living godly. And these are the types of men that we as women that are single should look for. If you're looking for a kingdom partner, that's what you should look for, because you want to build with somebody who has that kind of godly mindset. Not somebody who doesn't have that. The man has to have the mind of Christ. So the thoughts and logic of Christ, okay, the behavior of Christ, the mannerisms, the morality of Christ, these are things that he possesses. And he's never looking for, you know, a silly type of woman, so to speak, okay, or an immoral, a sexually immoral woman. He knows that that type of woman brings to him curses, spirits, demons, strongholds, bondages, principalities, all sorts of things, and of course, diseases. You know, when they say, according to healthcare, that when you sleep with one, you sleep with many, that is a true statement. In the spiritual world, when you sleep with one, you sleep with many. So he doesn't want a woman that has been passed around like that or doesn't have any morals when it comes to her sexuality or anything like that. He wants a woman with morals. So we have to do that. And of course, we as women want a man with those morals as well, that he's not doing that either, because that can also make a man very, very confused and double-minded. So he's not chasing a woman who is always half-dressed or who attracts demons like we talked about the last time. He is chasing a woman who wants a godly man, and he's the one that's going after her. She's not going after him, because he wants somebody that doesn't bring him shame and diseases and curses, like I said. That's what he wants. That's what he's looking for, because the mind of God is holy. The mind of Christ is holy. So we want somebody who's holy with him as well, every step of the way, to help him make decisions, strategic planning, to even pray together. That's what he needs in a woman. That's what he's looking for, an excellent wife, okay? And of course, he builds everything on a solid rock, which is God. Everything is built on God, his word, okay? Praying, these are things that he does. These are disciplines that he has. This is what he aspires to. If he doesn't have him, he tries to build that discipline of prayer. He tries to become more of the man of God that God wants him to be, according to Proverbs 12 that we're talking about. These are the things that he aspires to, godly things, and he grows in his righteousness. He doesn't stay there arguing with people over things that don't matter. He's not wicked. He is really, really understanding of his salvation, how important it is, and how important his sanctification process is, and how important that is also for his family, his future family, his future wife. So he's really, really focused on that. And he loves knowledge, especially godly knowledge. I'm not talking about knowledge of this world. I'm not talking about apologetics and fighting with people over, you know, theology. No, he has a relationship with God, and he wants more knowledge that way. And because he is searching the word of God for that, and because God trusts him with that, God gives him even more insight. Gives him even more insight. Because that is the type of man that God wants in his kingdom, and to build his kingdom and to bring more disciples in, because he has the same mission that God has. God's mission is not to be fighting with people over salvation or to be fighting with people over whether or not they should sin. I mean, the answer is no, you shouldn't sin, period. You should be repentant. He wants people who think in that way in his kingdom to be leaders, to be so-called apostles, and I mean modern-day apostles, pastors, and everything, and even within their own jobs to be leaders. So that's the type of man that we should be looking for as females. And if men are listening, this is what they should aspire to, you know. And then, of course, women who have husbands, this is what your husband should be like, and pray about it. It's very possible. So now let's continue on in Proverbs chapter 12, verses 8 through 14. That's Proverbs chapter 12, verses 8 through 14. A man will be commended according to his wisdom, but he who is of a perverse heart will be despised. Better is the one who is slighted but has a servant than he who honors himself but lacks bread. A righteous man regards the life of his animal, but the tender mercies of the wicked are cruel. He who tills his land will be satisfied with bread, but he who follows frivolity is devoid of understanding. The wicked covet the catch of evil men, but the root of righteousness yields fruit. The wicked is ensnared by the transgression of his lips, but the righteous will come through trouble. A man will be satisfied with good by the fruit of his mouth, and the recompense of a man's hands will be rendered to him. So kingdom men are insightful and productive. They take their insight from God and pastors. They read the word of God, and they really pray to God often. And I mean every day. The length of time doesn't necessarily matter. It's more of them praying in the spirit. A true man of God does that. He's not so focused on his ego or wasting time battling online and being idle. And he really provides for his family. He has a job. He makes a living, okay? I'm not talking about, okay, if you lost your job or something, that's different. But even if he lost his job, he's working hard to get his job, and he's praying to God to actually give him that opportunity. Okay, and he gets that opportunity usually because he's been righteous and he's been staying away from sin and he's been praying to God to lead him, and he's following God's lead in terms of the job that he takes on. This is what kingdom men do. Okay, they don't sit around idle all day on Instagram doing nothing most of the day except causing trouble and causing anxiety to others. People who do this are actually quite wicked. They think that they're helping people, but it's actually wicked, and they're actually moving at the hand of the enemy, and the enemy is enjoying it because they're making other people anxious. Even their family, they're probably making anxious, but they're not bringing any food to the table. They also don't covet, or they're not jealous of what other people have, other celebrities or anybody else has. They don't want a lot of money because somebody else has it, or they don't want that car because somebody else has it. They are okay with what they have. They are content with what they have, and their contentment comes from their contentment in Jesus Christ and also God. So they're not looking for things. Their joy is not in things, okay? Their joy is in God and Jesus Christ, and whatever they have, they are grateful for, and they know that they worked for it. Okay, and they are hard workers. They are diligent workers. They are providers. Women, you want a man who can provide for you. Guaranteed. You don't want a man that you need to necessarily always provide for, because that is his job, according to the Bible, to provide for you and the family. Not saying that you can't have a job yourself, but he really, really needs to be that way. I'm not saying he has to be rich, but he has to be a provider, and he has to be working. He cannot be idle. God doesn't like when men are idle. And the thing is, when men are idle, they can get into other things. And they always make good judgments. So they're not going to go for, again, like I said before, they're not going to go for a woman who's sexually immoral, because they know that that's going to affect their temple. They know that's going to affect the Holy Spirit within them. They know that it diminishes, in a way, their relationship with the Father. They're not as close to the Father through Jesus Christ as they were before, because they've been sinning, they've been fornicating. So they make those wise judgments not to do that, not to invade their temple, and then also invade your temple if you end up being married. These are decisions that they make. They also make good budgetary decisions. And they also don't put on airs or acts, meaning that they don't act like they're rich when they're not. They don't act like they have it all when they don't. They're not phony at all. Okay, so they're more focused on their life, they're focused on their family, they're focused on the kingdom. They're focused on, if I build wealth, I know that's for the kingdom. I'm going to help the kingdom in some way. Okay, I'm going to start a ministry. I'm going to build a church. I'm going to do things for the kingdom that the kingdom needs, that God has placed on my heart. This is how they think. And you want to be led by somebody who thinks this way, not somebody who is online every day, spreading lies and nonsense every day, or arguing with people every day that has on stuff that has no bearing and shows no fruit. And they always bear good fruit because they're righteous. That's what shows that they're truly saved and sanctified. It's the fruits that they bear. It's the good work that they do. It's the fact that they're so focused on being the best that they can be at their job according to what God's standards are. They do their jobs ethically. They don't do anything wicked to get ahead in their own careers, because God sees that too, and they know that. And everything that they do is grounded in God. So this is how they're productive, and they're very insightful, and they make wise decisions. And you need a guy who makes wise decisions, because he, again, has to lead you. Not saying that you can't make wise decisions yourself, because you have to as a child of God as well. But it's very important that a man does that, because if you have a double-minded man, or a man who's not of God, it's going to create a lot of unnecessary problems for you. It's going to bring you a lot of warfare. This type of man doesn't want to bring any spiritual warfare to you at all. So he's trying to live righteously. He's trying to live a repentant lifestyle. And he thinks towards the future. Just like you are supposed to be a future thinking person, so is a kingdom man. He thinks towards the future. Nothing startles him. Nothing rattles him. He doesn't take part in the fear mongering of the day. No, he thinks, what is this about? Let me pray to God about it. Let me see if he can go in and control this and make this more beneficial for everybody so that I can continue to build the kingdom. That's the way he thinks. He's not sitting there talking about end times 24/7 or talking about completely horrific things 24/7, but not actually having a solution as to how to resolve it or a prayer to use for it or a psalm to use for it. That he is very, very forward moving. Things like the Great Reset don't scare him. Those type of agendas don't scare him because he knows that his God is stronger. Okay, let's continue on in Proverbs chapter 12, verses 15 through 22. That's Proverbs chapter 12, verses 15 through 22. The way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but he who heeds counsel is wise. A fool's wrath is known at once, but a prudent man covers shame. He who speaks truth declares righteousness, but a false witness deceit. There is one who speaks like the piercings of a sword, but the tongue of the wise promotes health. The truthful lip shall be established forever, but a lying tongue is but for a moment. Deceit is in the heart of those who devise evil, but counselors of peace have joy. No grave trouble will overtake the righteous, but the wicked shall be filled with evil. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but those who deal truthfully are his delight. So kingdom men are honest and dignified. They're not foolish, and they don't rely on their own understanding at all. They rely on the Bible, and they read the Bible with the power of the Holy Spirit, not their own flesh, not their own intelligence, not what, you know, a famous pastor says or a famous person says or some badly researched information. No, they read the Word of God according to the power of the Holy Spirit in them. That's how they read and understand it. Because you cannot understand the things of God without the Spirit of God in you. You just cannot. That's an actual verse in the Bible. You can't. You can't understand the things of God with your spirit man. So their spirit man is not as active as, of course, their Holy Spirit when they're saved, right? So they really, really use that whenever it comes to reading the Word of God, interpreting it, and making decisions. They use the Word of God to make decisions in their life, okay? And they're not liars either. They're not liars. They don't lie. They don't. And if they get angry, they think before they speak. In fact, they think before they speak all the time, because they know that if they do that and if they seek God, they seek his counsel before they speak, then there's going to be a good result for all parties involved, for the kingdom even, okay? Whether that's at work, whether that's a brother or sister in Christ, whether that's a relationship issue, a marriage issue, they know to think before they speak. And if anything happens, you know, because they're human, they repent of that quickly. Because they don't want to be chastised by God. They don't want to lose their benefits. They don't want to lose their protection. They don't want to lose their favor with God at all. They know that they did wrong and they repent immediately. These are the types of men that women have to look for if they're single. And if you're already married to a man that's Christian, you have to pray for him to have these qualities. And this is something that you can pray for because this is God's will. It's in his word of how he wants men to be. You can pray Proverbs 12 over your husband if you'd like. Okay? And again, he's not a liar. He does not bear false witness. He doesn't bear false witness against anyone because he knows what damage that can do to that person and their family, their career, their life, and also what damage it can do to him because you reap what you sow. And so he doesn't want to sow that bad seed. So he doesn't do that either. Okay? And he never has wicked plans and plots. No, he has solutions that bring peace and order and stability. Peace and order and stability. And I'm sorry to bring up the whole social media thing, but I know that's a very, very big thing, and that's how a lot of people are getting information. So he thinks before he posts. He seeks God before he posts. He seeks godly counsel before he posts anything. Because his whole desire is to bring somebody closer to God and to give somebody information that's going to impact their lives and that's going to edify them, that maybe even will rebuke them and have them change their behavior, so to speak, according to the Holy Spirit, and repent of it. Okay? So these are the things, this is how he focuses. This is the way he focuses. This is the way he thinks. He's not out there fear-mongering. That's not even on his mind. But people who don't, and they call themselves Christians, they really have to watch out, because they think that they're doing something good, but they're under a delusion, because what's happening is that they're bringing forth anxiety. A true man of God does not try to bring forth anxiety and fear in people at all. They try to exhort, they try to uplift. And even if they're rebuking for a purpose. The rebuke is to bring them back in relationship with God so that the person can confess their sin and repent and build that relationship with God. These people are men of truth. Kingdom men are men of truth because they know that's what pleases God. They know that God is a truthful God. He hates lies. He says it repeatedly over and over again through his grace so that you get it, so that you understand how much he detests it. So they're very into pleasing God, and they are honorable, and they're dignified. And really, that's what we should look for as kingdom women. If we want a kingdom partner, of course, that we want to build life with, because, and I call it again, kingdom partner, because there's a purpose there. It's not a boyfriend. No, we don't do that in the kingdom. Okay. And then, of course, for women who have husbands, they can definitely pray and use this proverb as their means of prayer, because this is beneficial to her, her family, and her life, her favor, her protection, everything. So everyone, let's continue on in Proverbs chapter 12, verses 23 through 28. That's Proverbs chapter 12, verses 23 through 28. A prudent man conceals knowledge, but the heart of fools proclaims foolishness. The hand of the diligent will rule, but the lazy man will be put to forced labor. Anxiety in the heart of a man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. The righteous should choose his friends carefully, for the way of the wicked leads them astray. The lazy man does not roast what he took in hunting, but diligence is man's precious possession. In the way of righteousness is life, and in his pathway there is no death. So kingdom men are knowledgeable in their diligence. And when they do obtain knowledge or they have a plan, they make sure to conceal it until the correct time. And whose timing matters? Only God's timing matters. They really pray on that. They meditate on it. When I mean meditate on it, I mean meditate on the Word of God. So they really think about that. They really activate the Spirit and pray to God for direction as to, okay, should I reveal this? Should I launch my business right now? Should I launch this plan right now? Should I leave this job and go to another job? And they keep it quiet even while they're going through interviews. They don't tell everybody at work, oh, I'm going for an interview. Or they tell everybody, they see, oh, I'm going to have an interview. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. No, they keep that concealed until they actually even get the job. Okay, and they pass their background check. That's how they operate. Because you need to keep things concealed. And you know why? Because you can experience warfare just by not keeping it concealed. People can put things out there. You don't know what people are doing. You don't know if they're witches or not, or warlocks, for all you know. You don't know what organizations they belong to that do that type of stuff. So it's better to keep them concealed. And the only person to know is really you and God. And maybe, okay, if he has a kingdom partner, she can know. Or his wife can know. That's okay. But they know to keep it concealed. And his wife would know to keep it concealed because she's a woman of God. The kingdom partner will know to keep it concealed because she's also a woman of God as well. So this is what you have to look at when you're looking for a man. That is he just a blabbermouth? Does he have foolishness in his heart that allows him to just speak anything? Everything that he's doing, he posts. Everything that he's doing, he puts out there. And he tells everybody, he's a braggart. He brags. And he talks too much instead of sitting there and being focused and thinking of the future. This is not a man that can lead you. And if he's Christian, he really needs to work on that. When I mean work on that, I mean really seek God and really seek proper discipleship. Okay? And then also, He always seizes opportunities. He always seizes opportunities. He sees an opportunity and he seizes it and he works through it. He actually makes it through. That's very important. While a lazy man doesn't. Lazy man that doesn't seize opportunity is not going to be able to have food for the house. It's not going to be able to build a good livelihood for him and his family. And he's not going to be able to help the kingdom that much at all. Because even if a person has wealth, God usually gives a person wealth so that they can help the kingdom out. Give people jobs. Give the money away to somebody who needs it without asking for any money back. These are things that you have to look at when you're thinking about a man. And they always have life abundantly. Somebody who's righteous always has life abundantly. Okay? They live life more abundantly. They have the Holy Spirit active in them. Whereas somebody who isn't righteous, it's always something bad for them. They're always sinful, or they're happy in their sin and they're really not saved. What could I say? And they always know how to choose friends wisely. They make sure that their friends are in alignment with the Word of God, in alignment with God. Okay? They are equally yoked even in friendships, because they know that if they have a wicked person, that could influence their decisions. That could also bring bad spirits and demons and curses into their life. Yes, just that friendship. Okay? So they're very careful with who they're friends with and who they associate with. And they use the Word of God as their barometer as to who they choose as their friends. And this is very important, girls and ladies. This is very important because you want to make sure that his friends are not wicked. You want to make sure that his friends are not people that will push him towards cheating or lying to you. Okay? So obviously you shouldn't be friends with somebody who's into doing that. And that's not a man of God at all. Nope. If that's what he's doing, he's not a man of God. I can boldly say that. So you want to make sure that this is what you're looking for when you're thinking about a relationship with a man. You have to really make sure that everything is in alignment with God. And women, if you have husbands, of course, again, pray for him to have these qualities, because it's beneficial to you and your family, especially also if you have like a son, to model that in their father, you know? So these are definitely things that we should always focus on when it comes to choosing a kingdom partner, even having male friends, and of course, wanting those same type of qualities in our husbands if we're married. And men, if you're watching this, this is definitely stuff that you should look at as, hey, maybe I want to pick up these qualities. Maybe I want to really focus on this and pray to God to give me this, all right? Yes, you can pray for him to give you those type of qualities, absolutely. If you truly believe in God, he would want you to have those qualities, because that's how you're going to get far in life, and that's how you're going to be able to glorify him to others and bring other people into the kingdom of God. Everything surrounds that. And this is really something that you can really only see if you have the Holy Spirit active in you, which means, again, you have to stay away from sin as much as possible. And any introduction of it, anything that would make you sin, any demons, any spirits, anybody that would bring that into your life. So these are definitely qualities that kingdom men have. So everyone, let's open up our Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 through 33. That's Ephesians chapter 5, verses 22 through 33. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish. So husbands ought to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as the Lord does the church. For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and his bones. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, let each one of you in particular so love his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband. So kingdom husbands, you know, their wives, their family life, their marriages are holy, okay? And so, but before we even go into that, I want to go over something that I missed in the last one. Diligent men, which are of course kingdom men, they're never subject to a government or a system because they're hardworking and they put the kingdom first. They seek first the kingdom of God in everything, okay? So they're not subject to that. They're subject to God, and they realize that no matter who's running the country, God is their president, okay? So they are not a slave to any system or any government, never that. I'm not saying that they can't see government assistance if needed, but they know that that is just a temporary thing, and that is just so that they can move forward, of course. But they're not angry with what's going on in the government. They're not obsessed with it because they know that they have God. If you have God and you're obsessed with that, you really have to see. You really have to pray to God about that. Okay, I mean, this is for the men if they're watching. They have to really pray, and even women. You have to pray to God about that, because you should really see, you know, that you have to seek the kingdom of God in everything. If you start to do that, everything else will come to fruition. The job that you need, according to God, the business that you want to start, because he knows that your mind is in the right place, because you're not just going to use that for yourself. You're not going to use just that knowledge for yourself. You're going to use it for the kingdom and to advance the kingdom and to also bring more disciples into the kingdom of God. So that way you're focused on that system and not the government. You're focused on building and not on, oh, the great reset. So that's why it's important for the man who you're with, whether he's your kingdom partner, your husband, thinks in that way. All right. And another thing is that they're not anxious. They're very calm and peaceful for the most part. And if they do have anxiety, because they're human, they seek the word of God. They pray about it. And if other people are anxious, they give a good word. So now let's talk about them as husbands and, of course, women as wives. So women are supposed to be subject to their husbands. So this is why it's so important that when you're in courtship, I'll call it, when you're trying to find a kingdom partner, meaning that you're going to marry this man, you have to ensure that he has those Proverbs 12 qualities. Because could you imagine being subject to a man that has high anxiety all the time, is fear-mongering all the time, is rude, is obnoxious, is wicked, cheats on you? You can't. It's going to be very hard for you to be subject, but the Bible calls you to be subject to the man, to your husband. So you want to make sure that he has these qualities, because if he has any of these bad qualities, that's going to make it very hard for him to lead you. You can't be led by that. Naturally, you don't want to, because you have qualities of God. If you both have the Holy Spirit in you, then it's more orderly. And God is a God of order and stability. So if you get a man that's unstable and you're supposed to be subject to an unstable man, you have an unstable marriage, okay? So you have to make sure that whoever you're dating has those qualities, and it doesn't matter how long it takes. This is not about what society thinks about when you should be married or not. No, it's not about how long it takes. It's about the quality. And is this man ordained by God to be with you? That is the question. Whether it's 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, doesn't matter. You don't rush God in these things, okay? And then, of course, husbands are supposed to love their wives. They're supposed to love their wives just like Christ loved the church. Because a man who doesn't love his wife doesn't love himself. Why? Because when they get married, they become one flesh. Another reason why it's so important to stay away from sexual immorality. They become one flesh. So think about it. If you're becoming one flesh with a guy who is demonized, what are you going to bring in? Demons. You're going to bring in curses. Okay? But if you're becoming one flesh with somebody who is not into that and is prayerful and is into the Word of God, that brings stability into your life because you're also a woman with the Holy Spirit that has those same qualities. Okay, so that man has to love himself just like Christ loved the church and Christ died for the church. This man has to be willing to die for you, literally. Okay, he has to be willing to do that. And a wicked man is not willing to do that. He's all about himself. And when God says love himself, he doesn't mean it in an arrogant way. He means he respects himself. He respects his body. He respects his temple. He respects his mind. He respects everything according to the Word of God. And he's to wash his wife with the Word of God, meaning lead her in the Word of God. If she's upset about something, he is to use scripture to, you know, remove that sadness. Okay, he's to use scripture to advise her, to lead her, to guide her, so that she's just as holy as he is. Just like you would do the same thing for him, give him scripture and everything whenever he's feeling down, seek God when he's feeling down as to how to handle that. So he should do the same. Okay, so these are the basic qualities that a man should have, a kingdom man should have, whether they're a kingdom partner, a husband, a guy who's single and he's in the kingdom. These are the qualities that they should possess anyway as Christians. Okay, so I want to thank you all so much for joining us, and you know, feel free to contact us with any question that you have and everything. The next time we meet, we're going to talk a little bit more about kingdom families. Then after that, we're really going to go into, you know, kingdom business and finances and everything. Okay? Thanks again and have a blessed week.